from coast to coast and around the world, it's time to praise the Lord. Watching the number one Christian network in the world. Join us on Praise the Lord from Tulsa, Oklahoma, as we bring you anointed pastors, evangelists, teachers, authors, and other special guests with testimonies and teaching to encourage and inspire, and music to glorify God as we lift up Jesus Christ as Lord. From the Rock Church, Tulsa, Pastor Billy Joe Watts.
Hey, this is Pastor Billy Joe Watts, and it is time to praise the Lord. I am so glad that you tuned in today. And listen, I've got a word for you. We have two powerful guests that are going to be on this show today. It's not like all of our guests are not powerful, but these two individuals are absolutely special. They are incredible. We've been in relationship for many years, and I want you to have the opportunity to get to know these two ministries that I really believe will absolutely bless your life today in an incredible way. I want to open up by reading from the Word of God in Psalms 119. Now, this Psalms I absolutely love, because when I was in Bible college, I would read this Psalms every single day and meditate on the Word of God. But in Psalms 119, grab your Bible, verse number 89 in the Living Bible, it says these words, "Forever, O Lord, your word stands firm in the heavens." It goes on to say, "Your faithfulness extends to every generation. Like the earth you created, it endures by your decree, for everything serves your plans." I mean, I believe that with all of my heart. Job reminds us that we shall decree a thing and it shall be established, and the light of God's favor will shine upon our ways. What a great show we're going to have today. And I believe that as the word of the Lord comes forward today, that there will be things that will be decreed. There will be things that will be established. We are going to pray for you today, and we are standing and believing God that today will commence and begin the rest of your life in Jesus Christ. And I believe that as the Bible declares in one transliteration, that as you come boldly to the throne of grace today, it says, "Come boldly to the throne of love." I absolutely love that. Forever the Lord's word is established and settled in the heavens. Hey, if you just tuned in, I'm Pastor Billy Joe Watts, pastor of the Rock Church right here in the beautiful city of Tulsa, Oklahoma. And what great things we have planned for you today. So I want you to grab a hot chocolate, get your Bible, get ready, keep your heart open, because I really believe that God is going to minister to your heart and do something special in your spirit to help you to continue to grow spiritually and to grow in the things of God. The best thing that I can say to you today is that we're believing, as Paul declared, having done all to stand, you need to stand, therefore, where the Word of God is concerned and the Spirit of God. We're going to encourage your heart by this song by Brother Donnie McClurkin, "Stand."
This will be enough.
No,
just do it.
When you've done all you can, and it seems like it's never enough, and what do you say when your friends turn away and you're all alone, all alone? Tell me, what do you give when you've and there's nothing left to do. You just stand and watch the Lord see you through. Yes, after you've done all you can, you just tell me, how do you handle the guilt of your past? Tell me, how do you deal with the shame? And how can you smile while your heart has been broken and filled with pain, filled with pain? When you've given your all, yeah, seems like you can't make it through. Child, you just stand when there's nothing left to do. You just stand and watch the Lord see you through. Yes, after you've done all you can, you just
back right here in the studios of TBN, right here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I want to take this opportunity to make sure that you call into the station, that you are partnering, sending in your love, sending in your support, and certainly sending in your prayers for the continuation of Christian television. Right now, I want to take this opportunity to introduce my first guest, a powerful woman of God from Houston, Texas. She is the co-pastor of Joint Heirs Fellowship Church. She is the founder of Erica McCrutchen Ministries. And I want you to give a warm TBN welcome to Pastor Erica. To Pastor Erica, welcome to the set. Welcome to TBN. You have been an absolute incredible inspiration in the lives of many, many people. You and your husband, John McCrutchen, you pastor in Houston, Texas, Joint Heirs Fellowship Church, and you have Erica McCrutchen Ministries. You're in women's conferences. You're traveling around the world. Your latest book, or your newest book, Gripped by the culture. We're going to talk a little bit about that today, but I want you to just talk to our TBN audience, tell them a little bit about your life, your mother, your father, your upbringing in West Palm Beach, Florida, your six brothers and your three sisters, or your five brothers and your 10 sisters, however that worked, your grandmother, who was a wonderful woman of God, who was a prayer warrior. And I suspect that that part of your life and your ministry, you're here today because of those prayers that were sown so many years ago.
Yes, I come from a big family.
Huge family.
A very large family. There was nine of us. I'm the baby of nine.
Yes.
And of course, as you know, I had one brother that's in the R&B. I have a very musical family and a very athletic family.
Yes, sure.
And my father, historically there in West Palm Beach, was one of the first black police officers that came upon the police force, and later he became public defender and so many other things. And of course, you know, my mom being mom, and my grandmother was a Pentecostal preacher on my father's side.
Oh my gosh, that's
and,
right.
And there was always a strong heritage of faith in our family. And that's been a wonderful route for me.
Yes.
Now, I came to know the Lord as a student at the University of Florida.
Yeah, that's
in Gainesville.
Right.
So if you know Florida Gators, you know, SEC.
And whatever.
So that was wonderful years. And it was there in college that I got saved. It's interesting. I grew up in Pentecostal circles, but I did not come to know the Lord until I went to college.
Yes, that's right.
And of course, I wanted to go to Florida State. But my father said, well, you know, Gainesville was nearer, closer to home.
Sure.
And he felt that would have been a better place. So I submitted to that and went to Gainesville. But it was a greater picture. God had a greater plan for my life.
Wow.
And while there, I got born again there as a college girl. And God has done some tremendous things in my life. And from there, I met a pastor, Pastor Ronald Thomas, and he's with the Lord now, but he brought me out to camp meeting, Brother
sure.
Hagin's ministry. And my first introduction to Brother Hagin was he gave me a book for Kenneth E. Hagin.
Wonderful.
And that was The Authority of the Believer.
Mm,
and then from that, then I began to come out to Rhema, coming to camp meeting. And that was in the 80s, the early 80s.
Sure, sure, sure.
And I've been there, and the Lord began to move in my heart about coming to Rhema, and that's where you and I met.
Sure, absolutely.
Class of 88 of Rhema Bible Training Center. And from there, God is just, I met a wonderful husband there.
Oh, boy.
He's my husband, John McCrutchen.
So you are co-pastors of the Joint Air Fellowship Church.
We are. After finishing Rhema, we went back to Houston.
Yes.
His home.
Mm-hmm.
Houston is his home. And we pioneered there in 92. The church, Joint Heirs Fellowship Church.
Wonderful.
And then we've been pastoring since then, and it's just been wonderful.
Well, I know. Let me ask this question. I know that you've been involved, even when you were at University of Florida,
mm-hmm.
involved in student ministries and
yes.
different things that were going on when you were born again. Bible College, Pioneers of Church. You're the founder of Erica McCrutchen Ministries, of course, as we've said. But there's also this element of what you do. You're in conferences. You have a heart.
Yes.
It seems to me. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, which I'm rarely wrong. No, I'm kidding. But there's an element there of really an emphasis in the lives of women ministries.
Mm-hmm.
Later on the show, we're going to be talking a little bit about Catherine Kuhlman. And another wonderful ministry that we'll introduce to our audience today. But talk a little bit about that, just your emphasis in the lives of women, women that are growing up in the image and the likeness of Christ,
sure.
and really finding their place as all of your years of experience have taught you, finding your space,
sure.
finding your place in the body of Christ where the plan of God for your life is concerned.
Yes. Billy Joe, growing up, I saw my grandmother. She was grandmother to me. But I saw my grandmother serve as a pastor, but nobody told me she was a pastor.
Sure, sure.
She was grandmother to me, but we had a circular pastor who would come first and third Sunday, but on those second and fourth Sundays, she would be fill in as a pastor. So she was pastoring.
Right.
But nobody told me anything.
Right. Nobody told
right.
me.
Nobody told me nothing.
Right.
And so coming to know the Lord myself and as a college student, I the Lord has just done things. It's not the things that I worked to do, but sure. It was just there and it needed to be done. And so I found myself in situations where I've ministered to college campuses. They're calling me for come and minister and pray with the students and doing things at the University of Houston since we were in Houston now.
Sure, sure.
And so I began to see that need for women needing to be built up, women to know who they are in Christ and that the Word of God works for them. Some of them coming from traditional backgrounds where women weren't allowed to or weren't permitted to be in ministry or they had a special place in ministry. And I wasn't persuaded of that from the Word of God.
Sure,
And the scriptures tells us over in Acts, he said, in the last days, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh.
Yes.
So if you have flesh and you know the Lord, then you ought to have a great expectation of what God will do in your life.
Amen.
And so that somewhat kind of catapulted me into a new arena with dealing with women. So yes, I go to college campuses. I've gone to conferences. I've ministered women's conferences and banquets and dinners and all kinds of things. And
sure.
So the Lord has blessed me and it's just become a part of me. Part of my outreach is what I do.
Sure.
So well,
it's a powerful thing because I mm-hmm. see you and your husband not only as pastors and conference speakers, but yet also entrepreneurs. I want to talk a little bit because I wanted to get to this. Your new book, mm-hmm. Pastor Erica McCrutchen, Gripped by the Culture.
Right.
There's so many powerful things that you've said in here. The chapter on cultural Christians or church and cultural dress codes and different things and sensuality in America today or whatever the case might be. What really, and I have read the book and I love that because everybody, did you read it? I read the book. I think I read it in 2 days. Mm-hmm. It's very engaging. For the studio audience out there, what encouraged you or what inspired you to write a book called Gripped by the Culture?
Well, as a pastor, being a pastor now for, it's 20 years, 20 plus years now, we increasingly began to see the falling away of biblical truths in the church and how the culture had begun to creep into the church and has crept into the church.
Yes.
Where the church now has begun to accept the things of the culture rather than the scriptures. Things that are directly spoken about in the scripture that the church now is saying, well, you know, we can't be so hard on people or we can't be, you know. And so with all of that going on, it was like, look, we got to really begin to address these things because these things matter to God. Because if he put it in the Word and he made it very plain in the Word.
Yes, that's right.
Then therefore we as the body of Christ have a assignment.
Mm-hmm.
And God has called us to be the salt and the light to the world, and we are to affect and infect the culture rather than the culture infecting and affecting the church.
The book really does center on the message, what I would say one of the messages of this hour. It really does center on the fact that, as you just said, instead of us being infected by the culture, we should be infecting and impacting, you know, the culture. You know, Paul said in one transliteration, it literally says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. A translation says, don't fit into the culture of the day without even thinking about it. And I think that we have a responsibility and a spiritual obligation to do our due diligence to follow the Word, to follow the plan, and to impact the world around us. What's your thought there?
That's exactly right. The whole concept after you get born again, the work of Jesus Christ in the life of the believer is that he's conforming us unto the image of his son.
Yes, I like that.
Once we get born again, then that's what we ought to be conforming to.
Yes, yes.
That's why we renew our minds daily. It's a daily walk.
Daily walk.
And we are not to. We, as a matter of fact, the scripture tells us that we ought to reject those things that's contrary to the Word.
Yes.
But the church has gotten to the place in so many manners, in so many ways, that we have become more accepted of the things of the world.
Yes.
When we should be rejecting those things.
And
that's what grace teaches us to. Grace teaches us to reject those things that are contrary.
There's a big time word called tolerant or tolerance so there's this push. Maybe perhaps to get some of these things, well, they're old fashioned or we don't really need those in the modern church world today or whatever the case might be. So, you know, the book really does a great job not just explaining the cultural influence upon the church, but what we can do as believers to continue to preach the Word, live the Word,
That's right.
and really impact people for the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
As my wife, Teresa, would often often say that your life may be the only Bible that an individual might read.
That's so true.
During the course of a day, or a course of a year, mm-hmm. or the course of a month, or on your job, or whatever the case might mm-hmm. be. I have to say that it is very, very engaging. At the end of some of the chapters, you give some arguments and some points,
sure.
As to some key points as to what we can focus on in terms of what being gripped by the culture,
sure.
Really, really means. I know that when I think about wonderful ministries such as Catherine Kuhlman and Brother Hagin and Lester Summerall, I know, sure. that you were a big supporter of many of these wonderful ministries, Oral Roberts, mm-hmm. and all of these great people. They emphasized a God that was strong and a God that was firm and a word that was unshakable.
That's right.
In terms of the way that you and I are called to live, mm-hmm. Within the culture today. If you had to sum up the book and could leave just a word of encouragement for those that are viewing, mm-hmm. today, what would you say to someone who has been gripped, gripped by the culture? What would you say to that individual?
I would say to that individual, for change to come, you have to know what the Word of God says.
Yes, that's good.
Go back to the Word, and simple, do what it says.
Yes.
Do it.
Yes.
James tells us that we deceive ourselves if we hear it and don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
The liberty and the power is manifested in our lives when we are doers of the Word, not just hearers.
Yes.
Of the Word.
Yes.
So I would encourage the believers to consider the Word. Look at the Word. Look at it in context. Apply the Word to your life. And then do it.
Yes.
And then they'll find themselves free from the culture.
Yes.
And the culture trends. And not only will they find themselves free, they will also find that the change and the things that bind them in life will fall off of them.
Yes, that's good.
Because it has no power, it has no authority over,
yes.
the believer.
Yes.
No power, no authority. Many Christians are battling simply because they will not be obedient to the Word. And that's where the strength is.
You know, Brother Hagin used to always say, and I have to mention Dad, of
sure,
course, and
sure.
he used to always say that there are two books that were found in his library, mm-hmm. that he had authored, that if the average believer could get a hold of these two books, The Authority of the Believer,
yes.
And How to Be Led by the Spirit of God,
yes.
it would put him over.
Yes.
It would put him over spiritually in life. I know that you said that one of the first books that you were given, mm-hmm. as a new believer was The Authority of the Believer.
Yes, sir.
How to walk in that authority and walk in that power. And that's what you're saying. And if you've been gripped by the culture,
right.
then one of the things that we need to get back to foundationally is the Word of God. I read it in Psalms 119, yes. verse 89. Forever, O Lord, the King James said,
that's right.
your word is what settled in the heavens, and what a powerful thing that is. Not a whole lot of time left, but what are you seeing in these women's meetings that you're doing? You're a conference speaker, you're a woman of God, you absolutely believe in the power of prayer, the supernatural, though we ought to just do a supernatural show, hallelujah. But you believe in the supernatural. What are you seeing in these women's meetings, and what are many of these women, what are they needing from the Word of God?
Well, what I'm finding is that there are a lot of women who are hurting, who are dealing with fear, who are dealing with family challenges, mm-hmm. in their homes, mm-hmm. and raising their children. I'm seeing a lot of that,
yes.
That's going on. And they need answers. But you know, the Word of God teaches us how to raise our children.
Yes.
It teaches us how to be free from fear.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're seeing women delivered from fear. We're seeing them being ministered to, dealing with those tough issues of their life, dealing with abuse.
Mm.
A lot of that is in the church.
Yes.
It's in the church.
Yes.
And these things need to be dealt with. And so those are some of the subjects and things that we deal with. Dealing with abuse, how to overcome it, how to get out of it. It's just simply abnormal use.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
I know that you and Pastor John, mm-hmm. who I love, mm-hmm. you and Pastor John had an opportunity to take a trip to Israel. with a group of pastors, and
yes.
what a wonderful experience I heard,
yes.
it was. And how did that trip to Israel impact what you guys are doing today? Did it make the Word of God come alive?
Yes, it did.
You know, were you baptized in the Jordan River? You know, I'm not sure if you were. I don't think you guys were baptized when you were there. But I thought it was powerful, the testimony that you guys have on your trip to Israel,
right.
with a group of pastors and learning and really walking on the streets that Jesus walked on, and going and looking at some of the Pauline areas where, mm-hmm. Paul wrote and where Paul was. How did that impact what you guys are doing today? And how did it give you insight, that culture, into the culture that you and I have been called to serve today?
Well, you're absolutely right. That trip, but we've been twice, and the trip to Israel, it did change our lives.
Yes.
It did make the Bible come alive.
Yes.
And it also gave me a bigger picture of the hope that we live for,
yes,
knowing that Jesus Christ is soon to return.
Yes.
And he's gonna come back there in that holy land.
Wow.
And that's gonna be headquarters.
Mm-hmm.
And Jerusalem is a wonderful city, and it is a home city.
Yes.
And so it gave us a picture of what we know to look for, and it gives us the hope and helps us to understand that this life that we now live, mm-hmm. we do live it as unto the Lord, because
yes.
we know one day we will rule and reign with him. And it's going to be in that holy city.
Yeah, that's
so it blessed us greatly, greatly. It's an awesome.
What I thought the experience was absolutely incredible.
Yeah.
Listening to some of the testimonies that came back, mm-hmm. and how pastors were encouraged to go and really impacted by living or walking in the
sure.
area where the truths of the Word of God absolutely come
sure.
alive as you're there doing that. I know that the book covers things, church discipline and all of these
yes.
kinds of things. It talks a little bit about obedience to the Word and
yes.
obedience in your faith to the things of God. You know, the writer Luke wrote, you know, if you're not faithful in that which is another man's, how can God give you that which is your own? And so there are a lot of people that are motivated to do ministry, mm-hmm. motivated to reach out, touch lives. They want to try to impact people right in the areas where they live. If you
sure.
were dealing with someone who was just starting out, I know that you all have been pastoring over 20 years. If someone were just starting out in ministry and they were looking at the culture, looking at mm-hmm. church, what type of advice as a seasoned woman of God would you give young ministers who are saying, I want to impact the culture and I want to impact my world, where do I start?
In prayer. They must start in prayer.
Yes, amen.
They must start in prayer, and they have to do it by the Spirit of God. It's not like you're going to go and just get a building and say, I'm going to have church service.
Yes, that's good.
You have to break through the darkness that's piercing in the culture today.
Yes.
It has to begin in prayer.
Amen.
And that's crucial for a young minister that's starting out, and they must understand that. They got to understand that. That's very important.
Yes.
Very important. So they have to start there.
As one pastor said, prayer is the power plant of the church.
Yes.
You know, when I think about the yeah. Azusa Street revivals, mm-hmm. and I think about the moves of God, and I think about, again, Smith Wigglesworth and ministries that have impacted generations,
mm-hmm.
The foundations that were laid, the words that were given, the healing revival. I know that you're a very astute woman who has mm-hmm. studied some of these varying areas mm-hmm. and different things and the moves, the various moves mm-hmm. of the Spirit that have come through mm-hmm. God's generals, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
What have you seen in the last several years? You know, we have God's generals. We have a legacy that many, many men and women of God have laid for us. But what have you seen in the last several years as it relates to the legacy that many of these men of God have laid and left for us, this generation, mm-hmm. and what the generation is engaging or endeavoring to do today?
Well, I'm seeing several things. I'm seeing one, I'm seeing the Spirit of God moving on those who are seeking His face.
Yes.
And how He is helping, and people are being delivered. There is no corner market that people can have on the Spirit of God.
Yes.
He is not locked into a box.
And
I'm seeing God doing unprecedented things in areas and in places that perhaps we're not the norm or the orthodoxy of how things were set. Well,
yes.
This is the church, and
yes.
this is... I'm seeing God do things. I'm seeing God opening doors, things that I could never imagine. He's opening doors just in my life personally.
Yes, amen.
Places that He's placing me that I had no idea that He would do. And then yet I'm seeing, on the other hand, I'm seeing some ministers fall by the wayside
mm.
because they're not staying connected to those fundamentals
yes.
that God had, that was laid in their lives early on.
I like that.
Can't leave the foundation.
Yes.
Leave the foundation, then the walls crumble and
yes.
everything else. And so the Holy Spirit, though, he is moving greatly by His and through His anointing.
Yes, that's powerful.
Yes.
There's a few minutes left, and I want you to look into the camera. You mentioned about maintaining the foundation
sure.
and getting back to the Word, and the Word is firmly settled. There may be individuals out there that maybe perhaps spiritually their foundation generation has crumbled. You know, we've been talking about your new book, Gripped by the Culture. Mm-hmm. I mentioned, you know, Smith Wigglesworth, Brother Hagin, Catherine Kuhlman, Lester Sumrall. I know you guys were a big supporter of Dr. Sumrall. Individuals out who may be looking, who just tuned in and clicked on, and maybe their foundation has crumbled, or maybe they need to lay, go back and redo those new things, those old things that were once established in their lives. I want you to look in the camera, and I want you to pray for those individuals that are tuned in today who could be struggling, and maybe their foundation has become rocky. Maybe they've become so gripped by the culture that they're not sure how to get free and, as you said, reconnect to the Spirit of God. I want you to pray for those individuals as the Lord leads you right now in that camera.
Father, I thank you so much for your love for us.
Yes.
And there are some, Father, who are watching, who have left their first love. And Father, in the scriptures, you said to go back to the first love. So by your Spirit, Father, I ask you in the name of Jesus, if you will touch those people, and let them know that you love them, and you will receive them if they'll turn back and go back to you.
Yes, Lord.
If the foundation is shaky, Father, it's only because they left their first love.
Yes.
And it's only because, Father, that they have not been doing what you said do, and they've been gripped by the culture. Free them in the name of Jesus. I command you to go free from this culture and go back to our Father.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, for your love for him. Thank you, you'll receive him in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Hey, listen, we have been blessed by Pastor Erica McCrutchen, co-pastor of Joint Heirs Fellowship Church in Houston, Texas. The book is called Gripped by the Culture. What a powerful book it is. Thank you for being here with us today. Thank you for praying for those whose foundations might be off or shaky or loose that need a little tweaking and on. And I know that as you go and as you travel, you and your husband, John, Pastor John, you guys are in places making a difference in people's lives. We thank God for you. We thank you for being our special guest right here on the set of TBN right here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. What a great blessing you are. Thank you for your life. Thank you for your ministry. Thank you for the emphasis of helping people to be shaped in the image and the likeness of Christ. Our prayer is much success. Our prayer is that God will open up doors and get you in the places where you can absolutely grip help the part of our culture that has been gripped by the culture to go free in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Based upon the power of God.
Amen.
Because we believe in prayer. I want to encourage all of you that are tuned in, don't forget to write us at TBN, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, and it will absolutely be a great blessing. We want to make sure that you write in. Let us know how these shows are absolutely incredibly touching and blessing your life. I want to encourage you. Here comes Tammy Trent. Get to the foot of the cross.
Grace and suffering meet. You have shown me your love through the judgment you've received, and you've won my heart. Yes, you've won my the feet. precious and for beauty. And wear forgiveness like a crown. Come in to kiss the feet of mercy.
Hey, we're back right here on TBN. I'm Pastor Billy Joe Watts, pastor of the Rock Church right here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. My next guest is an absolute incredible man of God. He's a preacher, he's a teacher, he's a pastor, and he is quickly becoming an author. He is the pastor of Christian Fellowship Church in Mason City, Iowa. He is the founder of Shane Philpott Ministries. I want you to put your hands together for my friend, Shane Philpott. Hey,
amen.
Man.
God
welcome.
Bless you,
welcome to
thank
the set.
You.
Welcome
you,
to the show.
You.
I have been looking forward to this moment for many, many months. We knew that we would have an opportunity to be on the show at some point together, and it worked out that you could come on this week. You have been in the middle of a whirlwind, television interviews, articles being written, teaching in Bible schools, teaching at Christian schools, making appearances at universities, all because you just wrote a new book called Catherine Kuhlman, The Radio Chapel Years.
Yes.
What an incredible book it is. Our last guest is a new author. You're a new author. And I want you to talk today about not just Shane Philpott Ministries, what you're doing in traveling the world to preach the gospel, which is absolutely incredible, but you've written a book that has caught the eye and the attention of many, many people. I believe one of the most notable books written about the life of Catherine Kuhlman, who I've studied some, and I have some insights into some things that she's done. So we're traveling, we're preaching, we're writing now, we're pastoring in Mason City, where the Radio Chapel Church actually was established and founded.
That's right.
So
that's
talk
right.
a little bit, talk to us about it. We got to hear about this. Tell us what's happening with this book and what's going on.
Well, Pastor Billy Joe, I'm glad to be here on TBN and be able to, I mean, what an incredible story.
Yes.
Of this, not just national, we're talking global faith icon, faith pioneer
yes.
of the 20th century.
Yes.
And I did not know, you know, what she had done in the city that I'm in. I'm just in a little town, 28,000 people. I mean, we're the frozen chosen. It was 17 below the other day, my wife said. And so glory to God, I'm down here with you
yes.
in warmer climates. But, you know, Catherine Kuhlman, what an amazing spirit-filled, spirit-led woman of God.
Yes.
And she pioneered and helped pastor a church in Mason City, Iowa by the name of Radio Chapel.
Yes.
Her and her husband, Burles Waltrip, many people don't know, some are aware they were married at the time. And through the mountaintop and the valley of what they experienced in my city, literally cost her marriage years after that.
Wow.
But she went on to recover. Is that not the story?
Oh, that's God.
Is that not
the
story?
He's a God of restoration.
He's a God of restoration.
Absolutely.
And so God, through a series of really amazing prophetic events, you know, back in 2005, we were in a believers meeting one night in our church. You know what I'm talking about as a pastor. We just worshiping God and praying and around the throne. And man, this prophetic utterance began to come out of me. And God began to speak about restoring things in our city and making things right in the nation. In fact, he said this. He said, I need you to say things that have been left unsaid, do things that have been left undone, and finish what was left unfinished. That's a mandate.
Wow.
I had no idea what this was about. And the Lord in that prophetic word says, as it was in the days of Daniel, so shall it be in your day.
Mm.
So I thought, well, what did Daniel do when he was trying to figure out, you know, events from his time?
Sure.
He went back and studied the historical writings and the words of the prophet Jeremiah. So I said, well, why don't I start here? So I went back to the historical society of our town, went into the library. Brother, I spent the next 2 to 3 months every day poring over the stories and the articles of when Catherine Coleman came to my town.
Wow.
Pioneered this amazing church with her husband. And it exploded into absolute amazing success. Brother, it was there and gone in 23 months.
Wow, wow.
And they began in a revival tent. And by the time that thing hit its stride, it was running services 6 nights a week. 800 to 1,000 people a night were in attendance.
Shoo.
They're traveling from Canada, Texas, Maine to California, coming out to hear Catherine Coleman preach the word of God at Regent Chapel.
Mm.
They were doing crusades throughout the region. They had a monthly magazine that went out. They were airing on the radio 3 times a day.
Mm.
The name Radio Chapel was the name of their church.
Yes.
And this story just began to unfold. And so one day, to get to the good part, I'm meeting with the historian, and he said, well, have you ever thought about trying to track down the former associate pastors of Radio Chapel? I said, my goodness, I mean, are they still alive? He says, I don't know. He says, why don't you look for them? So on his advice, I started tracking them down. I found that the former associate pastors of Radio Chapel by the name of Keith and Mary Williams were alive and living in South Dakota.
Oh, my.
They
oh
were
my.
90 and 91 years old.
Oh, my goodness.
And I made contact with them, and we forged a relationship that lasted 3 or 4 years before they both went home to heaven. They're today now with Catherine and Glory. And I met with them, and Pastor, they gave me the story, the inside scoop, and they gave me Catherine Coleman's sermons.
Yes.
From her Colorado years, the Mason City years. They told me the story. They took me inside. The Holy Spirit drew back the veil of time.
Wow.
And we took a time-traveling journey and went back. We looked into the life of this faith icon, and we tell a story that has never been told.
Yes.
No one knows, no one had ever known up until now, the battle she fought, the greatest battle she experienced that almost took her out.
Right, right.
It cost her her marriage.
Mm.
It cost her not one, but 2 churches, and it almost cost her the call of God on her life.
I mean, you were so, you had become so intimate with the Williams that they even talked about the ordination service with you when Catherine Coleman and Brother Burroughs actually laid hands on them.
Yes, sir.
And set them apart for the ministry and in the ministry.
Yes.
What a powerful thing that was. Pastor Eric and I were talking about being gripped by the culture and mm-hmm. cultural things and church stuff and church people and blah, 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 and women in ministry. I agree with you. What a great icon of faith woman who was used by God in the areas of healings and the gifts of the Spirit and all of these kinds of things. You said that there were things in your research for the book and putting all of this together that you learned and that you found out. What was one of the most powerful things? Because we have people that are watching today this broadcast that are tuning in right now. They may be calling a friend saying, man, a guy just wrote a new book about Catherine Coleman. You got to hear this testimony. What was just a couple of wonderful things that you found out about Catherine Coleman that you did not know that might impact the viewer today who's listening to this story and who wants to find out about the Radio Chapel years?
Well, I'm going to take it right from the mouth of Keith and Mary Williams.
Yes, that's powerful.
And when we interviewed with them, they kept driving home the point that Catherine Coleman was so genuine, authentic,
yes,
transparent.
Yes.
These are traits of a woman of God that in that day, we are talking in the 30s, brother.
Mm.
She was forging national revival crusades just on her name. She was known as the Girl Evangelist.
Yes, that's right.
She's in her mid-20s. And I mean, she crossed denominational barriers. She crossed ethnic barriers. Mm. She crossed religious barriers, economic barriers, because she brought a powerful word of faith and the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
And the way you saw her in the latter years of her life is the way she was in her ministry when it began.
Yes.
She would enter onto that stage in that white and flowing gown. I have today was given to me a feather that she wore, a dove feather that she wore when she preached. Reminded her, you know, this wasn't some concept or something she innovated in her latter years to draw attention. She believed in this. She was this way. Her genuineness, her compassion. They said she was one of the first ministers they ever saw that came off the platform. Walked off the platform, came out into the audience, talked to the people, touched the people, prayed with the people. It was a church before its time.
Right, right, right.
Oh, I mean, they were using media and radio and magazines, and they were so open and real and genuine. And then you read the sermons, and we included 8 or 10 of those in the book. Never before seen, never before seen, till now have these sermons been transcribed and publicized for the community and for Christians to read today. It's amazing.
So the book actually includes some original sermons Catherine Kuhlman herself actually preached, actually ministered, transcribed, and placed within this book.
Yes,
so,
sir.
So the Catherine Kuhlman, the Radio Chapel Years by Pastor Shane Philpott, it's more than just a story about a woman. It has her personal touch.
Yes.
Her personal revelation from God included in the manuscript of this book.
Yes, when their ministry, and we tell the whole story because the lessons of that day apply to today, and I think it's a dual mandate, the Word of God. It wasn't just to tell the story of this faith icon and how she overcame.
Yes.
It was to also tell us today to watch out for what they fought then. They had a ministry that was hugely indebted. Everything was leveraged in debt. They had a very difficult time. He was known as the Louisiana pulpiteer.
Mm-hmm.
She was known as the girl evangelist. They were some of the very earliest, what we would consider, celebrity ministries.
Sure, sure.
And so they had all sorts of fame that followed them. They did not know how to process and deal with that fame well.
Mm.
The rapid explosive growth of the church, the impact of their ministry. You know, success in ministry is a dangerous thing.
Yes, yes.
It's a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
But everywhere a minister goes and the favor of God follows them, he has two companions that travel with him. It's success and persecution.
Yes.
And those two things will work together. And if you're not careful, not built on the rock, there's your advertisement for your church.
That's right.
If they're not built on the rock, glory to God, they'll crumble and fall. You know, the word says in the book of Psalms, if foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do?
Yes.
So we've got to go back to these foundational, just as Erica spoke about, going back to the Word.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says, seek out the ancient paths of our forefathers.
Yes.
Find out what their paths are. So these lessons from then, they apply to today. And it took her down. It took her ministry down. It took her marriage out. And it very easily could have cost the world the voice of Catherine Kuhlman.
Well, here's a powerful thought here. Very powerful, very significant. There was, you know, this started, this whole idea of writing this book and producing this and studying the life of Catherine Kuhlman began to start out of prophetic things. There were things that God told you, finish the unfinished, do what's not been done or what needed to be done.
Yes.
How has writing a book about the life and the times of Catherine Kuhlman, how has that impacted your church, Christian Fellowship Church, Shane Philpott Ministries, Shane Philpott the man, Lisa Philpott your wife, the Philpott family, the little pots, you know what I'm saying? how is this endeavor that God has exposed you to, because there are people that are watching and they need to know, they need to understand that these are things that God doesn't just do, but they're things to bring you to a place, as Catherine Kuhlman would say, to bring you to a place, to bring you to a place where your life is at its optimum, reaching people for the kingdom of God. How has it impacted your ministry and what you do to engage, as Pastor Erica would say, the culture today?
That is an excellent question, and I'm glad you asked it. When this story first became unveiled to me, and that's what it was. It was like the veil got drawn back.
Mm.
When I saw, you know, I live in the only city in the world that rejected Catherine Kuhlman.
Mm.
I mean, let's think about that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm in the only city in the entire world that rejected her ministry and ran her out of town on a rail.
Right.
When this story opened up to me, it lit me. And my church, I couldn't wait to get in the pulpit. I'd get in the pulpit and I'd preach part of the morning and then I'd share my research. You got to understand look what I uncovered this week. And I'd show parts of the interview from the Williamses. And my church got lit and my wife got lit and we just got behind it.
Wow.
And my friends did. I know you did. Different ministers that I knew, we began to share the story.
Wow.
And what I think so neat is what is in here is this. It is the up till now unknown and unseen part of her life. And what's powerful is this. It's the human side of a faith icon.
Yes.
You know, you mentioned Wigglesworth, Brother Hagin, who you and I both had the privilege to know and sit under.
Absolutely.
We hear about these great men and women of God and what they did. They blazed trails. Mm. They pioneered. But we only know of so many of their mountaintop experiences. Sure. What about the valleys?
Sure, sure.
What about the human part? What about, there's times in here where Keith and Mary Williams, and we even have pictures of these times where Catherine would weep by her desk, crushed by the opposition and persecution taking place. Mm. And they would cry out to God, God, help us to get through to people, help them to understand. You know, when the ministry was crumbling, Pastor Billy Joel, in the last few months.
Yes, yes.
Burles Waltrip and Catherine Coleman, they did kind of a press meeting with all the press. I mean, we're talking 26 states were covering the collapse of this megachurch.
Wow.
It was one of the first megachurches that the 20th century saw. Mm-hmm. And they're down and they're dealing with all of these reporters and all of these radio personalities are there. And they're all yelling questions at them and Catherine's weeping and some people have heard of these days. And Burles, he bangs his fist on the clerk's counter at the Hotel Hanford and he says, the first thing we have to do is deal with the spirit of suspicion that is corrupted the church.
Yes, that's good.
He tried to deal with the spirit of suspicion. You know, suspicion.
And that's a good word for the church today. The spirit of suspicion.
You're guilty before even consider being innocent.
Oh my God.
These are the days you and I live in.
Yes, yes.
The indictment that comes against ministers of God, did not Job experience this?
Mm-hmm.
Did not the word say that he comes regularly before the throne of God trying to accuse you and me?
Mm-hmm.
Did not Revelation say that the enemy is cast out into the world? He's the accuser of the brethren?
Yes.
If he's accusing us, why are we accusing one another?
Oh my God.
And so Catherine endured this and went through this, but you know, I'll give you something that viewers will love. You will see on her videos on television, they're being replayed by great Christian networks. People love to watch her on YouTube and all these different places.
Oh, yeah.
There are many times you'll see Catherine come out and begin to weep. And she would lift her hands weeping and she would say, no one knows what this has cost me.
Yes, yes.
This is the story of what it cost her.
That's powerful.
The church in Colorado, the church in Iowa, her ministry, her marriage.
Wow.
All of this
That's
crumbled
powerful.
Underneath the weight of opposition and persecution.
It is, again, in my thinking, one of the most powerful stories about Catherine Kuhlman that have been told. I've read the books. I have books. I have videos that I would show in
sure.
at the Bible college in
I
my class.
I remember you doing that.
Whereas those videos
right.
would run. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, you can look at some of those
yes.
on YouTube and on it. I mean, this stuff is available. My students would fall out of their chairs onto the floor under the anointing of that ministry. I want to bring this point out. This month literally
yes.
commemorates the 40th year anniversary of the death of Catherine Kuhlman.
Correct.
She died right here, Hillcrest Hospital, here
yeah,
in
right
Tulsa.
Here in Tulsa, yes.
Here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. There's an article that'll come out. There's things that are going to be done to remember in remembrance of Catherine Kuhlman. And so 40 years have passed since the death of Catherine Kuhlman. And so what does that mean to us today? Brother Hagin has passed, these great icons, men and women of God. God is raising up men like Pastor Shane Philpott and Pastor John and Erica McCrutchen and Pastor Teresa and Pastor Billy Joe Watts and a whole host of people. What does that mean to our generation today to look back and to reflect on the last 40 years of the death of such a powerful woman of God?
Well, look what we're here discussing today.
Yes.
40 years, and she's still, her life, her ministry, her awareness of the person of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
She really was a pioneer in that area.
Yes.
And she would come into meetings and just stand there in the presence of God, and the power of God would descend to a meeting. She wouldn't preach, and the power of God would come in.
Mm.
I think the effect isn't just in memory and how we memorialize what she did.
Yes.
But I think it's a residual still.
Yes.
There's this residual power that's still in the church today, or wanting in the church today, I should say that. Because we've got churches and we've got clones. We've got imitations. We've got people trying to formulate and design what she did. Doesn't need to be formulated in design.
Yes.
Holy Spirit just needs to be welcomed into that place.
Yes, I love that.
And when
that.
He comes in, and so we're seeing today, you know, Pastor, you know this. You and I talk about this. We're in a blizzard of information today. Technology has, we are in the days of Daniel where information is being increased. Men are traveling to and fro. And we are living in this day of there's so much, so many things everywhere vying for attention. Paul called it many voices in the wind.
Yes.
Here, 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 trying to get our attention. But there is, you know, Burroughs and Catherine, I have all these advertisements they would run in the paper. I have these sermon outlines. You know what they said all the time? The old time gospel is always up to date. They would say, they'd have it, they had it on the side of their cars.
Yes.
I have photographs of their parades they would do. The old time gospel is always up to date.
That's good.
Is that not what the Holy Spirit is telling us today?
Yes.
The cross is still up to date. The blood is still up
yes.
to date. Jesus is
yes.
still up to date. You and I are up to date.
Yes.
I don't have to figure out a way to be relevant. God is relevant.
Amen. Listen, we got a few more minutes left, but I want you to pray that out. Pray for the people that are viewing. You said something very significant. We don't have to try to emulate, duplicate, prognosticate, whatever the case might be. What we have to do is allow the Holy Spirit in.
Right.
Is to invite Him in.
Right.
You know, Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. It's one of the most powerful songs I think that have ever been written. I want you to look in the camera. I want you to pray for those people that may not know Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. I want you to pray for women and God out, women and men of God out there who may be pastoring, but they're looking for that edge. They're looking for the very thing that put Burroughs over and Catherine Kuhlman over. It was their ability to yield to the Holy Spirit
yes.
and to invite him in.
Yes.
So look in that camera and pray for those.
Father, we're so grateful today for every viewer that has tuned into this. And they're everybody right now at home is getting a seed planted right now. And Father, in Jesus' name today, I pray for every. First of all, Father, I want to pray for anybody that doesn't know Jesus. And you can just speak that at home right now out loud. Father
yes.
God, I come to you today.
Yes.
And by the blood of Jesus Christ, I thank you for salvation for my life. I
yes.
ask you to be the Lord of my life.
Yes.
And I thank you for redeeming my life from destruction. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. And if you prayed that, congratulations. But secondly, I want to pray for every saint that's believing to overcome.
Yeah.
Every saint that's struggling, fighting the fight, every preacher, every pastor that's about to give up.
Yes.
I'm taking authority today right now over the spirit of suspicion, over compromise, over opposition. And I'm telling you right now today, the Bible said in Romans 8, I'm getting excited.
Woo!
All things work together. God calls us all things to work together so that it might benefit and be a blessing to your life that you might be an overcomer. I pray that today by the authority of the Word of God,
yes,
and in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Listen, this has been an absolute incredible blessing.
Glory
for those
God.
Of you that are tuned in. I'm Pastor Billy Joe with Pastor Shane Philpott from Mason City, Iowa. His new book, Catherine Kuhlman, The Radio Chapel Years, in my thinking, again, is one of the most powerful, well-put-together books written about the life and times of Catherine Kuhlman. It will absolutely bless your socks off. It's a historical narrative. It's a spiritual narrative, a move of the spiritual narrative. And as Pastor Erica McCrutchen would say, it's a cultural narrative because there were things that were going on back then that were just simply precedented and unheard of where this great woman of God was concerned. Pastor Shane, thank you for being here today.
My pleasure.
Thank you for allowing God to use you to write such a book to bless the body of Christ. Hey, this is Pastor Billy Joe. I want to encourage you, stay right there. Don't you touch that dial. We have something else coming. I've got a word for you to absolutely strengthen you, to encourage you, and to bless your life. But right now, I want you to enjoy A Friend Like That by Hawk Nelson.
I need somebody on the inside. I want somebody who can set me free.
This is Pastor Billy Joe, and this has been an absolute incredible show today. I want to close out with a word that I believe will absolutely bless your life. A good friend of mine by the name of John Mason wrote a wonderful book called An Enemy Called Average. And I want to talk to you today as we close out our show today that average is your enemy. The Bible in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7 says, the beginning of wisdom, to get wisdom, skillful and godly knowledge, for skillful and godly wisdom, wisdom is the principal thing. And the King James says, in all of thy getting, get an understanding. I believe with all of my heart, as the Amplified Bible says, that God wants you to have discernment, comprehension, and an interpretation of what his will is concerning your life. Hallelujah. I believe Pastor Erica today and Pastor Shane Philpott, as we talked about their books and as we talked about the word of the Lord, I believe that Catherine Kuhlman's life demonstrated what it means to have a life that is totally surrendered to God. Remember in Genesis chapter 3, beginning with verse number 8, you know, the Bible says that Adam and Eve heard God walking in the garden. They heard God walking and talking to them. Adam, where are you? And I'm asking the question today as we talk about average is your enemy. Where are you today? It says in the Bible that they heard God walking in the garden. Another translation says they heard the sound of God walking in the garden. And the reality, my friend, is that you're going to have to hear the sound of God walking in your garden. You're going to have to hear the sound of God and the voice of God walking in your life and walking in your garden, and what you're going to do with that sound that you and I hear as it relates to the word of the Lord. You know, in Joshua chapter number 1, it says something very, very good in verse 6. It says in the Today English Version, be determined and confident, for you will be the leader of these people as they occupy this land which I promised their ancestors. Just be determined. And you know, I want to close out today as we talk about average is your enemy. It's an above average life that I believe God has called you to live. But he says, just be determined. Be determined. Be confident. You're going to make it. I was teaching in my coaching class for men just the other day, and I was telling our men, we were talking about possibility thinking. And it was Jesus who said, those things are possible to those. All things are possible to those who can believe. And I believe it all in my heart that it's imperative that you and I believe. It's imperative, according to Joshua 1, that we are confident, that we're confident and determined to walk out the plan of God, to live out the word of the Lord, to see supernatural things manifested in our life, and to live above average. There was a missionary by the name of missionary Wilfred Greenfield who once said that the service we render to others is really the rent that we pay for our room here on earth. It is obvious that man himself is a traveler. Man himself is a traveler. That's traveler. Get it? Traveler. Man himself is a traveler. And that the purpose of life, my friend, is not to have and to hold, but to give and to share. For this, there can be no other meaning. I believe that our guests today have expounded upon that concept, the ideal of not having and holding, but the ideal of giving and sharing and allowing your ministry and your life to be used as an impact in somebody else is life. I believe that there's no other meaning. You know, I have a saying at the Rock Church that meets here every Sunday morning at 10 o'clock here at the Union Performing Arts Center in Tulsa, Oklahoma. We have a saying there, you should never start your day in neutral. When a car is in neutral, it doesn't move, it doesn't glide, it never arrives at its designation. I believe it's imperative that we never start the day in neutral, but we start the day being purposeful, intentional, and determined, as I read here in the Word of God. You know, there were two fishermen that went out on a fishing expedition, and while they were out there fishing and trying to catch the big one, hello, while they were out there trying to catch that fish, a great storm broke out. And one of the men in the boat looked at his companion and said, oh my God, man, there's a great storm coming. We're in the middle of it. What do we do? Do we row or do we pray? And to which his wise companion looked at him and said, let's do both. I believe that as we've heard from our guests today, that we're living in a time that commemorates the 40th anniversary of the death of Catherine Kuhlman, a great icon and woman of of God and woman of faith, I believe that you and I should row and pray. When the storms of life come, we should row and pray and believe God to get to the other side. Hallelujah. I believe that's very important. In Romans chapter 11, verse number 29, it says that God's gifts and God's call are irrevocable. He never withdraws them from whence they are given. He does not change his mind about those to whom he gives his grace and to whom he sends his call. I believe, beloved, that the call of God on your life, the plan of God for your life, whether you are a pastor, I understand that there are 1,500 pastors that quit the ministry and get out of the ministry every single month. I know that most pastors don't have friends. I know that most pastors don't have a confidant that they can confide in. I know that statistically a lot of pastors struggle in the area of family and the area of relationships. I know that most pastors are over. Hello, somebody. Amen. I know that most pastors are overworked, but I'm telling you that your call and the plan of God where your life is concerned, according to Romans 11, it is irrevocable. God never changes his mind about what he's laid on you and called you to, which is something that you and I must always remember. It goes on in Romans 12 verse 6 to say in the Living Bible that God has given each of us the ability to do certain things well. And I believe with all of my heart of hearts that there are things that God has empowered you to do and anointed you to do, be it in the marketplace, be it in the church, be it in some professional vocation. I believe that gift, that plan, that call is irrevocable. But I also believe that there are certain things that all of us have been anointed and blessed to do well. If God has given you the ability to prophesy, then prophesy. If God has given you the ability to serve others, then serve others. If he's given you the ability to teach, then you teach powerfully. If God has blessed you, it goes on to say, with money, then you be generous with your money in helping others. Life, as Helen Keller once said, life is an exciting business and most exciting when lived for others. That's the impact and the mission statement of the Rock Church, serving God and loving people. That's what this is all about. That's what our show has been about today as we've talked about gripped by the culture. Paul said, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, present your bodies a living sacrifice. One translation says, the whole holy kind. Hello, the holy kind. Present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Don't be transformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Another translation says, don't fit into the culture of the day without even thinking about it. I believe that there's a plan. I believe that the Spirit of God is moving. And as Pastor Shane Philpott said, I believe that the Holy Spirit is endeavoring to manifest his gifts, to manifest the power of God, to the working of miracles and on. I believe we are trying to cultivate a culture at our church that simply says to help people win. To help them win where their life is concerned. But I want you to remember, average is your enemy. Someone put it best and said it this way, only a mediocre man is at his best. Only a mediocre man is at his best. I believe that God's his plan and purpose for you is to rise above the mediocre. I believe that God's plan is for you to live above average, because average is your enemy. Someone said that average means being run-of-the-mill or mediocre, insignificant. It's the lazy man's cop-out. It's lacking the guts to stand up in life, and it's living by default. Being average is to take up space for no purpose, to take the trip through life and never pay the fare. Hello, to never pay the fare, to return no interest on what God has placed in you and what God has planted in you, to not use what you have for the greater good of life, to be average is to be forgotten once you pass from life. The successful people are remembered for their contribution. The failures are remembered because they tried. But the average people, the average, the silent majority is just forgotten. I believe with all of my heart that God doesn't want you to be forgotten. I believe that this is a day and an hour that you and I are living in, that we must rise up. We must get up. We must stand up to our full nature and our full stature in God, and where Christ in us, as the Bible says, is the hope of glory. But getting wisdom, comprehension, and understanding is very significant in finding out and searching out the plan of God where your life is concerned. You know, King David really understood that. He understood that it's character in the midst of the it's compassion and character in the midst of the conflicts of life that will bring you out on the other side. He fought a Goliath. He looked at Goliath and said, "You better go lie it down." Get it? Goliath. Okay, all right there. Goliath down before I knock you down. And I believe that if you're facing a giant today, you must, like David, run toward that giant, rise above average, because average is your enemy, and you face that giant with your mouth open. You should decree and declare that I am an overcomer. You should decree and declare that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. You should decree and declare that wherever the soles of your feet tread, that God is going to give you victory there. You should decree and declare that all of my needs are met according to his riches and glory. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You should decree and declare that this book of the law shall not depart out of my mouth, because everywhere I go, if I do whatever it says day and night, I will make my way prosperous and I will have good success. And that means, baby, living above average. Hallelujah. I believe this. This is what we believe, and this is what we embrace, and this is what we subscribe to from the Word of God. In Psalms 139, verse 14, the psalmist said, "I will confess and praise you, for you are fearful and wonderful, for the awful or the awe wonder of my birth. Wonderful are your works, and that my inner self knows quite well." Listen, friend, listen, you have to know inside of you that God is calling you to more. You have to know. Your inner self needs to know quite well the plan and the purpose of God that is ahead of you. And as Brother Joel Osteen would say, yeah, you know, there have been some difficult times, and there's some stuff out there ahead of you, but I believe God's got a better life for you. Amen. I believe that. I believe that there are things are on the horizon. I believe that the sun is going to come up in the morning. You know, over the years, I've had the privilege of traveling around the world and preaching the gospel, and I'm telling you that it doesn't matter what it looked like at takeoff. Once that plane began to take off and it began to soar, and once it got above the clouds, guess what, baby? The sun was shining. And I'm telling you, the sun, the S-O-N, is shining today, and God's plan is for you to rise up and be everything that he's created you to be. You know, I heard this a number of years ago, that you have eyes with 100 million receptors that allow you to see the flight of an eagle and the intricacies of life and the beauty of a sunset. Receptors that take in light at 187,000 miles per second, blown up into 3D in your mind. 100 million receptors. Your ears have 24,000 fibers that vibrate when you hear sound. Fibers that help you to hear. Your body has 500 muscles. Your body has 200 bones. You have 7 miles of nerve fibers that allow for movement and agility to help you to walk and to keep your equilibrium. Your heart beats at 36 million times a year. It pumps 600,000 gallons of blood and 60,000 miles of veins and arteries in your body. Your lungs have 600 million folding, fleshly, sponge-like tissues that help you to rid your body of gases and poisons. You have 5 quarts of blood that have 22 trillion cells, and in each cell, there are millions of molecules, in each molecule atom oscillating and shoo, 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 and turning over 10 million times a second. In every second that ticks off the clock of every day, there are 2 million cells in your body that die, and 200 million cells or 2 million cells that are born in your body again. The brain has 3 pounds of gray matter that contain 400 million pain sensors, 500,000 touch sensors, and 200,000 temperature gauges, baby. In other words, to sum it up, we are bad, meaning good. Hallelujah. You're fearfully and wonderfully made, and a person like that has to live his life living above average. I believe that average is your enemy. to stretch like Pastor Erica McCrutchen, or to stretch like Pastor Shane Philpott, to stretch like Catherine Kuhlman, and become everything that you were created to be is part of the significant part of a life well lived. Life is full of people that thought they would never become what they were created to be. Vince Lombardi was told that he would never be able to coach football, so why try? And yet there's a championship trophy called the Super Bowl that's named after a man who was supposed to be a failure. Harlan Sanders failed at everything that he ever tried to do. You're in good company if you've messed up or missed it in an area of your life. He tried to sell tires, insurance. He was a railroad conductor. He worked as a secretary. He failed as a volunteer for the volunteer fire department. Now, how does somebody fail as a volunteer for the volunteer fire department? But he went on with his 11 herbs and spices to establish Kentucky Fried Chicken. And you and I have moments of eating and picnics and family reunions where a man named Harlan Sanders refused to settle and refused to be average and refused to be mediocre. And even though he had failed at some things, he took one thing that put him over and made him a blessing to many, many people yet today. In Psalm 65, it says something very powerful. Verse 1, what mighty praise, O God, belongs to you in Zion. We will fulfill our vows to you, for your answer our prayers to all of the people will come. Though our hearts are filled with sins, you forgave them all. What joy for those who you choose to bring near, those whose lives are holy, enter into the holy courts. What joys await us inside the holy temple. It goes on in verse 9 of that same chapter to say, you take care of the earth and you water it, making it rich and fertile. I believe our Heavenly Father, he waters the earth, making it rich and fertile. I believe that as a believer, striving to live above average, striving to live out God's plan for your life, he waters you and makes your life rich and fertile. He blesses you. He comes to you. He makes you a blessing, as all of my mentors would ultimately say. You water the earth, making it rich and fertile. The rivers of God, here's what it says in the New Living Translation, the rivers of God will never run dry. I believe with all of my heart, it's very important that we recognize that no matter what goes on in life, the rivers of God will never run dry. Where it may seem like lack, where fear might try to creep in, the rivers of God will never run dry. I believe where your marriage is concerned, or where your family is concerned, or where your career is concerned, or friend, where the ministry is concerned, I believe with all of my heart, the rivers of God will never run dry. That's the promise of an above average believer. That's the promise of a believer that has given his life so that he can impact the lives of other people. Maybe you're a writer. Maybe you're a singer. Maybe you're a songwriter. Maybe you're a producer. Maybe you're a director. Maybe you're an administrator, or God has called you to head up ministries and to, as one translation says, to get people to work together. Whatever that plan and whatever that call might be, maybe you're not walking in it right now. I've got good news for you. The rivers of God will never run dry. They'll never run dry. You know, the word is full of people that were just like that. In the Far East, they plant a tree called the Japanese bamboo. During the first 4 years, they water and fertilize the plant, which seemingly with no or little results. Then in the fifth year, they again apply the watering and the fertilizing. And in 5 weeks' time, the tree grows to 90 feet in height. That begs the question, did the Japanese bamboo tree, did it grow 90 feet in 5 weeks? Or did it grow 90 feet in 5 years? The last year, it has exponential growth. It has explosive growth. And I believe that all of these years, God has been watering the water of the word and fertilizing your life and leading you to the place and allowing your potential to come out and to come through. You know, I love one of my mentors, Dr. Miles Monroe, bless his heart, he and Miss Ruth. He used to always say the word potential means that which is, but is just lying there below its full strength. brain. It's kind of like chocolate milk. You put the chocolate in the glass, and you put the chocolate in the glass, and you put the milk on top of the chocolate, but it's not really chocolate tea until you stir it up. Hallelujah. So I'm trying to get you to stir up the latent potential of God inside of you, to remind yourself that God has called you and I to live a life above average, that which is, but it's just lying there below its full strength. My friend, I want to make you aware of something. The devil is after your potential. He doesn't want you to become everything that you should become. That word potential means, again, dormant ability, untapped strength. In other words, you have strength inside of you that you may not even be aware that you have. That word potential means unused success. There's unused success inside of you. There's hidden talent inside of you. It literally means capped capability. And it's my desire to help you to remove the cap off of your potential, to break out, to break up, to break through into arenas where you know you're blessed and you know you're anointed by God. And it may seem that you'll have to walk that out by faith so that God's plan can kick in where your life is concerned. But the enemy, as I said, is after your potential. And I want to give you my takeaways for today. I want to help you here. You know, there's some things that you can do to guard your potential. There's some things that you can do to ensure that when you get up the road and down the road, that God's plan will be made real in your life. Here they are. Number one is this. If you're going to walk out your potential and live an above average life, number one, feed your potential the fertilizer of good, positive company. Get some people in your life that believe in you. Get some people in your life. The Bible says iron sharpens iron, and a friend, the countenance of a friend. Number two, give your potential the environment of encouragement. You know, someone once said that encouragement is like oxygen to the soul. It was Mark Twain who once said that one compliment can keep me going for a whole month. Maybe there's one compliment or two compliments, but you need to give your potential the environment of encouragement. Number three, you need to drench your potential with the water of God's word. I believe that as you and I get into the word of God, we'll be strong in God, strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. We need the word of God. We need to not just do it, but we need to know it, and we need to utter it, and we need to chew on it every single day. Here's number four. If your potential is going to come forth and you are going to live an above average life, you must, number four, bathe your potential in the sunshine of personal prayer. I believe that that is so important, to bathe it in the sunshine of personal prayer. Men ought to pray and faint not. Never give up. Never quit on the gift or the anointing or the plan that God has placed within your life. I believe, as you and I do, that we'll be standing at the throne where we can find help and mercy to help in the time of need. Well timed help so that you and I can be a blessing to the world. Father, we thank you for those that are viewing right now in the name of Jesus. We thank you for blessing their lives, blessing their families. In Jesus' name I pray. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. Hey, I'm Pastor Billy Joe. Thank you for tuning in today. We've had a great time. We meet every Sunday morning at the Rock Church, at Union High School, at the Performing Arts Center at Union High School, every Sunday morning at 10 o'clock and every Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. I want to invite you to write in, like us like this local TBS station on Facebook, KDOR TV 17 at Facebook. Write us. Let us know how these broadcasts are being a blessing in your life. We're going to continue to bring quality Christian television that will encourage you, that will empower you, that will strengthen you to live above average and to live out God's plan where your life is concerned. And this is Pastor Billy Joe. As I often say at our church, I want to encourage you to keep standing on the rock. And right here from TBN, I want to encourage you to what? Keep praising the Lord.
This program has been brought to you through the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout North America and the world.